This is pre-Christmas broadcast from the Games History Series.
Surely you are already busy preparing for the upcoming Christmas.
Despite the ongoing pandemic, we want to spend this Christmas time with the family and enjoy this moment.
So we stand in lines in stores for shopping, check the list of gifts for Santa Claus, and in the kitchen the hustle and bustle, a bit like on a battlefield.
And in this spirit we want to make Christmas more pleasant for you, therefore the hero of today's episode is, probably well known to you, the game Diplomacy.
The show will be hosted by
Brian,
Libby,
Ryan,
Jessica,
Mia,
Victoria.
The idea for today's topic came to our minds in connection with the ending of the 2020 presidential election in the USA. Stormy, dirty, full of endless twists, crazy and completely unpredictable, in a word, exciting. Moreover, partly by correspondence.
You might ask, what does the diplomacy have to do with the presidential election?
Perhaps some of you know that the huge fans of this game were President JF Kennedy and Henry Kissinger. But this game ruins friendships, shapes careers, and for me is an addictive quarantine hobby. For some others, it was training for the Trump administration.
My friends, some of whom had never played before the COVID-19 pandemic, have quickly become hopeless addicts. Diplomacy might be an on and off obsession when played it at the home.
Michael Ellis, a conservative and now an obscure but potent player in the Trump administration, he played Diplomacy a lot.
In the absence of parties and happy hours and date nights, millions of Americans living under lockdown have regressed into pastimes like playing Animal Crossing, reading War and Peace, baking sourdough bread, or attempting to learn Romanian.
If you've never played Diplomacy, it might be hard to explain its appeal.
The game is not for everyone, but it is ideally suited for the kind of nerd who has a deep interest in international relations, geopolitics, or really politics of any kind, foreign policy's readership, in other words.
This is a game for people who dream about power in its purest form and how they might effectively wield it.
Beloved by President John F. Kennedy and former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, Diplomacy models the realist view of international relations, in which sovereign states rationally compete for spheres of influence, eventually achieving a stable balance of power.
The classic version of the game is set on a simplified map of Europe in 1901, at the height of the rivalry among the great imperial powers, England, France, Germany, Italy, Austria-Hungary, Russia, and Ottoman Turkey, that would eventually culminate in World War I.
There are no dice, unlike in other classic strategy games like Risk or Axis and Allies, and there are only two types of game pieces, armies and fleets.
Everything about Diplomacy is simple and easy to learn, but the actual gameplay is fiendishly complex, built around social interactions between seven committed players, each pursuing their own selfish interests through a series of ephemeral military pacts.
Part of what keeps Diplomacy interesting is its versatility. There are dozens, if not hundreds, of variant maps spanning regions and eras. But the spirit of the game is rooted in that pre-World War I moment when the Western imperial powers coldly, immorally divided up the rest of the world between them while maneuvering for strategic advantage in Europe. A fun, gentlemanly board game for them, and a series of massacres, genocides, and myriad other oppressions for millions of people on every continent who didn't get to play.
There are no moral or ideological distinctions among the great powers. Aside from geographic circumstances, one plays the German Kaiser, the British Prime Minister, or the Ottoman Sultan exactly the same way.
Diplomacy encourages its players to imagine themselves as grand negotiators redrawing borders with international peers at a summit, not as rulers charged with upholding any set of religious, national, or democratic values.
Risk is an evil game of quite a different sort. In war there are no winners, said someone. Arguments, negotiation, unlucky dice rolls. The first person to show any sign of weakness or be screwed over by unsympathetic dice is systematically ganged up on and dismantled.
It's a game for eagles and vultures, fighting hawks and carrion crows. It's a terrible way to lose.
I've seen more table flips in Risk than in any other game. But when it comes to potentially ruining real-life friendships, none of the above are a patch on diplomacy.
If you want a game that has broken marriages and ruined friendships, this is your game. If you want a game of epic plotting, tense confrontation, conspiracy, betrayal and backstabbing, then you're after the evilest game of them all.
One of the many remarkable things about diplomacy, zero dice. Unlike Risk, only one army is allowed in any one region. So moves and attacks are one and the same.
There is a region, and I want to be in there. If you're already there, then I'm attacking you. Conflicts are resolved by sheer weight of numbers, your army that moves, and your armies in neighboring regions that actively support you. Even numbers mean there are no winners and no losers.
Simply, nothing happens. The only way one army will defeat another army is with the support of armies in neighboring regions. Or with the support of armies from other nations.
Another remarkable thing about diplomacy, there aren't turns per se. Everyone's moves happen simultaneously.
All seven players write down their moves on a piece of paper and reveal them at the same time. Then those moves are all resolved, with simple rules to resolve conflicts.
Turns comprise of moving your armies, supporting the moves of your armies, or supporting the moves of other players' armies.
But you only have three armies, so all your negotiations will be centered on garnering support from foreign powers, and promising support for their endeavors whilst garnering support for your armies in exchange.
Mechanically, diplomacy is simple as a realistic war game can get. The balance of power between nations has been very finely tuned.
Clever tactics alone won't win you a game, although poor tactics may lose you a game. Ultimately, and unsurprisingly, it comes down to your ability to diplomacy.
Talk is a key feature in diplomacy. You're given 45 minutes to study the board, strategize, negotiate and renegotiate before making your very first move.
That sounds like a lot, but is only just sufficient to talk to every other party at least once and write your move. If you haven't written your orders by the deadline, then your armies just do nothing.
Subsequent turns are given a strict 30 minutes. A typical game will go for 4 to 6 hours. All real-world negotiating tactics are in play. Promise, threaten, issue ultimatums, and follow through, or not.
Declare neutrality and watch the world burn, hoping the wolves cannot collectively dismantle the turtle. Ally against a common threat.
Conspire with a dangerous opponent against a weak neighbor for your mutual benefit. Promise support, but lie. Promise support, but backstab.
Promise support and hiding your malice behind incompetency. Promise support, demonstrating your good faith by writing your moves in front of them. Only to pull out alternate moves from your other pocket.
Or tell them the truth. Next turn, I'm attacking you. Sorry, not sorry.
Diplomacy was published in 1959 by Alan Kauhama and has had an avid fan following ever since.
Chess was the first game to be played by mail. Diplomacy was the second.
Diplomacy was first played on the internet via email in 1983, predating the first Apple Macintosh, the development of HTTP, most Australian ISPs, the smartphone and MMORPGs.
The United States has held national diplomacy championships, DIPCON, since 1970. Australia has held national diplomacy championships since 1988, which was the same year that the International Championships for Diplomacy, World DIPCON, started.
People who love diplomacy.
Diplomacy is a work of art, a pure and perfect board game. Fortune and mechanics are stripped to the absolute essentials of the art of war.
By simple reduction, you're forced to realize that warlike love is chaotic, but it's not a game of chance.
It's about humanity, and relationships, and words. It's about cruelty and kindness, loyalty and treachery.
It's a good game because it's about people who are often less than good. It's a great game because it asks you, yes you. Who you really are, what you're willing to do and what you're willing to sacrifice when the promise of victory is on the line.
Diplomacy is the most evil game ever made because at the heart of diplomacy are the hearts of the humans playing the game. It forces you to see humanity as it truly is. And sometimes humanity is evil.
Kauhama speculated that his original inspiration for diplomacy was an article in Life magazine about the Congress of Vienna he read in 1945 at age 13.
In 1954, While still enrolled, he developed a game of strategy and alliances that put seven players in control of the major powers of the pre-World War I era.
In 1959, Kalhamer published his game as Diplomacy and printed 500 copies. After selling all of them in 6 months, he licensed the game to a publisher. Over the years, Diplomacy has been published in North America by Games Research, Avalon Hill, and Hasbro, and has been published in several different languages in other nations by various publishers.
Kalhamer's original face-to-face board game has also been played by male since 1963. He also published a game of four-dimensional exploration called Hyperspace. The instructions are at the Internet Archive.
Later he invented two other games, but neither achieved anything like the success of Diplomacy.
And this is the end of tonight's story. Let's go and play Diplomacy.
Of course, if you want to be politician, or lose your best friends.
Thank you to everyone for the time spent together.
We wish you Merry Christmas.
And we invite you to the next episode.
As usual on Sunday.
At the same time.
10:30 p.m.
Good night and see you soon.